Diabetes research supported by NIDDK has led to many groundbreaking discoveries to help adults and youth prevent, delay, and manage this chronic disease. Hi, I'm Dr. Griffin Rodgers, Director of the National Institute of Diabetes, Digestive, and Kidney Diseases at NIH. Joining me to talk about key studies and findings in our diabetes research and future efforts is my colleague, Dr. Barbara Linder, Program Director and Senior Advisor for the Childhood Diabetes Research Program within the Division of Diabetes, Endocrinology, and Metabolic Diseases at NIDDK, part of NIH. Before we cover some recent studies and findings, I'd like you to talk about the early days of diabetes and how your research focus and interests have evolved.
Yes, diabetes care has certainly changed over time. When I was in medical school, type 1 diabetes, which you know is frequently diagnosed in children, was monitored using urine tests, which is really imprecise. Then home glucose meters were developed, and that allowed patients with type 1 diabetes to check their glucose at home by doing a finger stick, and then they could achieve better glucose control. Now we have newer insulins, and more recently, many new technologies have been developed that allow patients with type 1 diabetes to attain better glycemic control and also to have a better quality of life, which is really important. Now, however, at the same time, we've seen the emergence of type 2 diabetes in the pediatric population, especially in teens and in minority populations. This increase in type 2 diabetes mirrors the rise of obesity in this country and has really created an important public health problem.
Well, you've seen many advances in diabetes research over the years. What are some of the studies that are expanding what we know about diabetes among youth and adults?
Well, let's talk about two studies. The first is the Search for Diabetes in Youth study. This is a 20-year national multicenter study that was funded by the CDC and NIDDK in order to better understand diabetes in youth. That study has just ended, and it's provided very important statistics for our country about the burden of diabetes in youth. So for example, Search reported that new cases of type 1 diabetes have been increasing at about 2% a year since 2002. And during that same time period, new cases of type 2 diabetes have increased at an even higher rate. Search looked at over 14,000 youth with type 1 diabetes and nearly 4,000 youth with type 2 diabetes. The other study is the TODAY study. TODAY stands for Treatment Options for Type 2 Diabetes in Adolescents and Youth. And this was really the first large study to focus on treatment of diabetes in teens. TODAY compared three different treatments for type 2 diabetes and very unexpectedly found that type 2 diabetes seems to be a much more aggressive disease when it occurs at a young age. So for example, in this study, nearly half of the participants were not able to achieve good glycemic control with the drug metformin, which is really the mainstay of treatment of type 2 diabetes in adults. Search and TODAY both found that youth with type 2 diabetes have high rates of comorbidities, things like high blood pressure and abnormal lipids, which we know are associated with heart disease. These studies also found unexpectedly high rates of diabetes-related health complications like eye disease and kidney disease. And this is really concerning.
Well, that's very important information. What are some of the lessons learned from Search and TODAY?
I think that Search and TODAY suggest that we may need to take a more aggressive approach to treating type 2 diabetes in youth. Since the emerging data suggests that this disease is progressing more rapidly when it occurs at a young age, which may be why metformin didn't work as well, perhaps we need to start treating with two drugs instead of just using one drug. And, you know, I also think that these studies highlight the importance of prevention, especially in youth, where type 2 diabetes seems to be so much more difficult to treat. I'd also like to note that both these studies have revealed important health disparities. So youth from minority groups are much more likely to develop type 2 diabetes. And when they do develop the disease, they seem to have higher rates of complications. And minority youth with type 1 diabetes don't seem to be using the newer technologies as frequently as their non-minority counterparts. And I think these health disparities are very concerning. We need to decrease these disparities so that we can achieve health equity in diabetes care. Now, you know, I will say on a more positive note, these studies have demonstrated that tight glycemic control matters. So just as in adults, if you lower your A1C, you do have better outcomes. Mm-hmm. And so that highlights how important it is for healthcare providers to be using these state-of-the-art approaches.
So very important lessons from the youth. So tell me, what are we learning about adults with diabetes?
Well, that's a great question. There's a lot going on in adults with type 2 diabetes. Let's talk about one study in particular, the GRADE study. This stands for Glycemic Reduction Approaches in Type 2 Diabetes, a Comparative Effectiveness Study. That's really a mouthful. A
lot of acronyms.
There are over 5,000 people with type 2 diabetes participating in the GRADE study, which is comparing four very commonly used type 2 diabetes medications. Mm-hmm. And we're hoping that this study is going to give healthcare providers key information about how to pick the best combination of drugs for their individual patient. And the study is close to being finished. It's going to wrap up in late spring. And so we're excited to hear the results over the summer.
Oh, that's great. Well, as research continues to provide critical knowledge about diabetes, are there things that parents and caregivers and youth can do now to help them better manage their disease?
Absolutely. There's lots of things that people can do to improve the care of their diabetes and their overall health. The most important is, you know, get your glucose under control. And, you know, one thing I'd like to say is that it's important to know that there's no one size fits all treatment for either type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes. So I think it's really important for patients to have these discussions with their providers and come up with a good treatment plan that's going to work best for them. The other thing I'd like to highlight is the importance of mental health. You know, caring for a chronic disease like diabetes on top of all the demands of everyday life can really be overwhelming. And I think we need to recognize that. And I think it's important for patients to talk about how they're feeling, you know, with their loved ones. And it's critical for healthcare, you know, providers to ask their patients about this so that they can provide referrals and resources, you know, if those are needed. Mm-hmm. We should also talk about things we should all do, which is aspiring to have a healthy, you know, lifestyle, choosing good options in our diet, for example. Mm-hmm. You know, this is hard to do. And I think for people who are trying to lose weight, it's important to think about coming up with a plan that has small steps that you really can manage. It's important to keep in mind that making changes is hard, that you're going to have setbacks and you need time and patience, you know, to change your dietary habits. And I think the same, you know, approach applies to physical activity. You know, sometimes people throw up their hands. They say, well, I'm never going to be able to run a marathon, but that's not what you need to do. You just need to be active every day. So if you can go outside and take a short walk, that's going to really make a contribution to your health. If you can't go outside, be creative. Think about what you can do in your, you know, household. Can you turn on some music and dance around, you know, with your family? And maybe the last thing to talk about is sleep. You know, I think we probably all don't realize how important sleep is for our health. And a good night's sleep really has a direct impact on diabetes. We know that if you don't get enough sleep, it affects your ability to control your glucose. So we should all try to get a good night's sleep.
Absolutely. Well, thanks for that very practical advice that I'm sure the listeners can take in right now. On things that we've learned from some of this important diabetes research in the past, what other research in diabetes that we can look forward to in the future?
Well, as you know, NIDDK is always starting new studies. I'd like to mention, too, that I'm personally involved in, so I'm really excited about that. We're just starting to plan a study to try to better identify which youth are really at risk for developing type 2 diabetes so that we could target prevention approaches and start therapy as soon as possible to hopefully improve outcomes and decrease the risk of developing these bad health outcomes that we're so worried about in this group. The other study has to do with gestational diabetes. This is a form of diabetes that occurs during pregnancy, and it has adverse health consequences for both the mother and the baby. So a mother's glucose directly affects how the baby grows and also increases the risk for the child to have later health consequences like obesity and type 2 diabetes. But we don't know really how the best way is to diagnose gestational diabetes or when we should diagnose it. So we're about to launch a new study in a large population of pregnant women to study their glucose and hopefully develop better ways of diagnosing gestational diabetes.
That's going to be very good information. And it's going to likely be useful for the mother as well as for the child. Wouldn't you agree?
Absolutely.
Well, you know, we're about to wrap up. I want to thank you again for providing such useful information to our audience. I want to thank my colleague, Dr. Barbara Linder, for talking with me about diabetes and the many research efforts designed to improve public health. And if you'd like more information, you can visit us at niddk.nih.gov and search diabetes. You can also follow us at niddk.gov on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I'm Dr. Griffin Rodgers, and thank you for watching.